Welcome to Understand with Unbabel, a new series where we dive deep into the issues, topics, and challenges facing us as we accelerate to a world without language barriers. I'm joined today by Professor Andy Way of the ADAPT Center at Dublin City University, also known as one of the fathers of machine translation. One of the fathers, Andy?
Well, Matt, I guess I've been doing machine translation for long enough that I could be one of the fathers of machine translation, but to be honest, people were doing machine translation a long time before I began. So I started doing machine translation probably in about 1988, and people more or less say that machine translation started around the 50s. 1949, there was a famous letter written by Warren Weaver, talking about the possibilities of machine translation, that we could look at some of the things that were learned from the war about coding and decoding and encoding, secret messages, and try to use the same sort of technology to process human languages.
And when do you think what was the next big breakthrough? Like, when do we get beyond that?
Well, people started to see the potential for machine translation around that time, and started to develop machine translation systems, again, all rule-based, all using linguistic information, both of the source language, the target language, and the contrastive language, contrastive linguistics in between. Around that time, and up until around the mid-60s, when the nadir of machine translation came about by what was known as the infamous ALPAC report, where it was essentially predicted that there would be no future for machine translation because of the problem of ambiguity, that machines would never be able to disambiguate words like pen, whether it's a writing implement or whether it's something, an enclosure that you keep animals in. So, from that point, especially in the US, funding for machine translation was canned for a long, long time. But of course, it was a requirement of many countries which have more than one official language, that they continue to offer documentation and information in more than one official language. So lots of machine translation research continued in places like Canada, in places like Europe, even though the funding was not available anymore. For another probably 10 years or so in the US.
So you talked about rule-based machine translation. Can you explain exactly how that worked, what its limitations were, and then what did it evolve into after that?
Okay, so on the Erotra project, it's a good example. What we needed to do, if we're translating, let's say, from English into German, was we'd have to write down a grammar of English, a grammar of German, and we'd need to write down a contrastive grammar of how English representations could be mapped into German equivalent translational representations. So you need monolingual experts of the source language, monolingual experts of the target language, and you need this contrastive linguistic information in the middle. So these people were few and far between. And I'm now used to work on German to English translation, so I could speak German. That was one of my languages for my first degree. So we were able to translate from German to English, and then from that representation of the English sentence, we would then generate an output sentence, which was a fully formed English sentence. Mm. But of course, it didn't work terribly well. It's very hard to write down specific rules of languages and get that then to map from one language to another. So around the same time, the computers were becoming more and more powerful, and we'd have more and more digital content online, some of it contrastive, what we call parallel documentation. And around that time, the statistical paradigm came in. Mm-hmm. So IBM started off building models of language, which seemed to be kind of heretical at the time. So the rule-based protagonists, which were dominant at the time, thought this was really, this is never going to work. You can't deal with translation by looking at sort of mathematical probabilities. But of course, it worked very well. The more it worked, the more it translated, the more documentation we had, the more training material there was to retrain the engines, and so they got better and better and better. And they were quite robust to any input, whereas the rule-based systems, as soon as you typed in a sentence, where it didn't have the linguistic coverage, it would just keel over and die. So these systems would always give you some output, which is a good thing. Up until probably from the late 80s until the mid 2000 and sort of 2015, around that time, it was recognized everywhere that, you know, statistical machine translation was the dominant state-of-the-art paradigm.
So you say statistical machine translation was the paradigm for pretty much two decades up until a few years ago. What's the latest thing?
Okay, so over the last 3 or 4 years, you know, the sort of neural machine translation has come along and really looks like, you know, sweeping everything before it. It's rapidly becoming, or has become, depending on who you talk to, the new state of the art. You know, so for example, in academia where I work, if you're not doing neural machine translation, you know, it's very hard to get a paper published these days in the very top machine translation conferences. So the very best conference this year, ACL, there are 15 papers on machine translation. All of them are on neural machine translation. And it started to be picked up by, you know, companies like Unbabel. There are very few, I think, which who are sort of placed and ready to offer neural machine translation to the level and quality that people expect. But along with that, there's been a little bit of over-gilding the lily, a little bit of over-hype. Mm-hmm. So some of the papers recently, there was a paper by Google in October 2016, which, you know, the title of which said it was approximating or coming very close to human translation quality. And as soon as you hear that, translators start to get a bit freaked. And part of my job is to try, you know, to talk not just at machine translation conferences, but also translator conferences. And we all know, you know, Unbabel know, you know, because you offer post-editing as a resource, you know how important the translators are, and you need to keep the translators on side. So the last thing we want to do is alienate the translators. And as soon as they see comments like, you know, approaching human quality, they start to fear for their jobs. They wonder what their place in the world is going to be, et cetera, et cetera. And that doesn't, you know, bode well for any of us. So I think, you know, some of this hype needs to be treated with some caution. There's an awful lot of promise there. The machine translation quality is often very, very good indeed, sometimes misleadingly good. So neural machine translation can produce very, very fluent outputs, which have nothing to do with the actual source language. And so are not good translations, but those will be very hard for a human to detect when they're trying to validate the final document before it gets sent off to a client. So there are pros and cons here. Many new researchers have come into the field of machine translation, so that's great. There's funding available for machine translation, that's great. Some of us who've been around the block a few years, you know, are being a little bit cautious about whether to throw away everything that we've learned so far and abandon SMT in favor of this new paradigm. But many others, including some old guys like me, have jumped already.
Interesting.
And you mentioned the role of human translators. I mean, do you think the truth is that there will always be a place for them in this kind of paradigm?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I always say, and I don't just say this, you know, to sort of suck up to translators, but, the translator will always be, the human in the loop will always be the most important part of that translation pipeline. You know, we system developers, we need human translations to feed into our systems from the word go in order to train our systems. Without that parallel data, you know, there's a source text at one point been translated by a human. We get as much of that data as we can. We feed that into the system and it starts to learn, you know, patterns and start to produce good translations. So if we think for one moment where we would be without translators, we wouldn't even be able to start. We use the human translations which are provided as our reference translations to measure how good the quality of our engines actually is. So again, you know, humans play an awful lot of different roles in the translation process. They also are able to look at the translations, and because I could build an empty system between a pair of languages that I don't speak. And we need them to validate the translations, to actually look at the translations and tell us what things the system is good at and what sorts of mistakes it's making so that I can try and fix those, you know, in the next iteration. So humans are absolutely vital.
So really, humans are moving up the stack in a way.
Yeah.
And they're not so much doing the grunt work of starting from scratch, or sometimes they are, but it's more, you know, let the machine do what it's really good at and then let the human elements kind of do the validation, do the correction, do that kind of updating of the source data.
Yeah, there's so much translation that's required. I mean, these translators are never going to be out of a job. And again, sometimes they just need to look at the output. Sometimes the output is absolutely appalling. You know, the MT systems can produce things which a human would never produce. You know, so wrong, it doesn't bear thinking about. And again, some of that should give the humans some comfort.
So if the likes of, you know, Google and Bing have apparently solved, you know, translation, like, what job is there left to do?
Okay, I always say to my students and at various talks, I say that, you know, Google is not a machine translation company. It's not even a search company. It's the world's best advertising company. And if it can find another way to sort of productize to monetize, advertising revenue, you know, it can drop machine translation tomorrow. Now, of course, you know, so we're not in the same game as Google. We're not trying to provide a robust machine translation system for any input. You know, I'm never afraid to go up against Google if I'm talking to potential clients or industry partners, because in a well-defined scenario where we have customized user data, we can always train an engine and feedback insights from the human translators to try to improve the engine, and you can't do that with Google. Google is a one-size-fits-all solution and has to be, you know, robust to any input whatsoever, whether you're trying to translate stuff about, you know, the weather forecast or shopping or, you know, my dog has a thorn in its foot, whatever. It has to translate all of that stuff. You know, we build our engines, you know, customized to the specific requirements of a client, often with their own data, and it's very, very easy to beat out-of-the-box Google.
So, Andy, you're here in Lisbon, staying with Unbabel for the next month or so, and we're working on a project together. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Yeah, it's a H2020-funded project by the commission called Interact. What we're trying to look at is how machine translation can help improve communication in crisis scenarios. So, you know, one of the famous examples was in 2010 was the earthquake in Haiti. And all of the medical supplies and the doctors and nurses turned up. The local people spoke Haitian Creole and nobody could understand what they were talking about. So they weren't able to administer the help that was needed. So we're trying to come up with a blueprint or a cookbook about, you know, how machine translation could be deployed in those sorts of situations should another similar crisis occur. We're already, you know, sort of experimenting with various, you know, language pairs and system setups to try to improve communication in those situations.
Is that in the form of kind of like written terminal work, or are you introducing kind of other kind of ways of interacting with such a system?
So the intention is, so we build machine translation systems, you know, whether they be statistical machine translation systems or neural engines, and we use Unbabel's translation platform to communicate with the language communities that you have, who will then look at trying to tell us insights about the translations that we have produced, and try to post edit the translations into acceptable target language output. And the whole project is based on the notion of internships. So I work in academia, so the academics come to industry, and people from Unbabel later on will come to DCU. And there are other project partners like Microsoft, Translators Without Borders. We're right at the beginning of the project. It only kicked off in April, it's an exciting 3 years ahead of us.
So looking ahead of the next 5 years, what excites you most about the field?
Okay, that's a very hard thing to predict. You know, if you think, you know, things like Twitter wasn't around, you know, 7 or 8 years ago. Facebook wasn't around 7 or 8 years ago. I think one thing which is definitely here to stay is user-generated content. So we're all publishers nowadays. With the advent of Web 2.0, you know, publishing used to be the domain of the big software providers like Dell or Microsoft. You know, they produce lots and lots of manuals in English that would need to be translated into all sorts of weird and wonderful foreign languages. But we're all contributing to that now. So the ability to deal with user-generated content is absolutely, you know, front and central. If we can't do that, if a company can't do that, then, you know, they're in danger of going out of business. So I think that's something that's essential for companies to take on board. And again, if you think that your current client's data is dirty, wait until you've seen user-generated content. That's really dirty.
Are you talking about mine?
Well.
Great. So thanks so much for joining us today, Andy.
Okay, no problem. Thanks,
so you've been our first guest on the pilot episode of Understand with Unbabel. Thanks for watching.